Hello, and welcome to this edition of the Kansas Candidates Forum right here on Smoky Hills Public Television. I'm your moderator today, Becky Kaiser from Hayes Post. Joining me is from the media, representing the media, Patrick Lowry, who, of course, is with the Hayes Daily News. He is the editor and publisher. Welcome, Patrick.
Good to be here.
And, of course, we're going to be talking about and talking to the candidates for House District 111. I would like to first introduce the incumbent for House District 111. To my left, Representative Sue Boldra. Welcome, Sue. And then the challenger to my right, far right, is Eber Phelps, Democrat from Hayes. Welcome to you.
Thank you.
We have also, before we came on the air, did a coin flip to determine the order of the questioning that will be done by Patrick Lowry today. It was heads, and Ms. Boldra claimed that, so she will go second, last, as we go to the questions. But first of all, we will ask the candidates to give us their opening statements. Each will have a minute 30, 90 seconds to give us their opening statement about why they're running for this particular position. Then we will move on to the question portion. Those will be asked by Mr. Lowry. Each question will be approximately a minute 30, and the response again about 1:30, 90 seconds. Finally, as we get closer to the end of the show, we will ask each candidate to offer a closing statement again about their reasoning and logic and why we should vote for one or the other running for House District 111. So first of all, we will start with our opening statement from the current representative of House District 111, Ms. Sue Boldra of Hayes, who is a Republican. Sue.
Thank you. I'd like to thank Mr. KinderConnect and the staff of Smoky Hills Public Television, Ms. Kaiser, Mr. Lowry, Mr. Phelps, and all of you for watching today. This is the people's business, and the people should stay informed. I am Sue Boldra. I'm running for my third term as a representative for the 111th District, which is the southeast quarter of Ellis County. I currently serve on the Education Committee, the Telecommunications and Energy Committee. I'm also the Vice Chair of the Agriculture and Natural Resources Committee. I was appointed to serve on the Special Committee for All Day Kindergarten and on the Special Committee for K-12 Success. I am the Caucus Chair for the MS Society in the House. Many of you know me as a career educator in Hayes. I first started teaching at Felton Middle School, which became Hayes Junior High. And I've been a longtime teacher. I taught at Hayes High, and I now teach at Fort Hays State University. I'm natural board certified, and I've been doing this a long time. We owned a business in Hayes, Sportsman Supply, for 20 years. I grew up on a family farm, and with commodity prices where they are right now, the family farm is in dire distress. I thank you, and I look forward to our conversation today. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Boldra. We will now go to Mr. Eber Phelps, the challenger, who is a Democrat, also a Hayes resident, and ask him to please give us your opening statement.
Thank you, Becky. Well, again, I'm Eber Phelps, candidate for the 111th Legislative District, which encompasses all of Hayes and Munger and Victoria. Pretty much in that area, everything south of Interstate 70. I have currently been serving on the City Commission in Hayes. I served in the legislature a number of years ago up until about 2012. And of course, just recently, my term as mayor of Hayes ended, but I am still on the commission. I'm also involved in a number of ways in the community. I'm the chair of the Ellis County Extension Board of Directors. I'm also on the Public Development Committee, which is under that umbrella. And with my term as mayor ending, I recently had my term on the Hayes Public Library come to a close as well. But in the meantime, I have been pretty much immersed in the business of the city. But also, since 2012, I followed the legislature quite closely and have been real concerned about some of the areas that have been, I think, overlooked due to the massive tax cut package in 2012, which has done great harm to our state and continues to do so. I believe I made my decision to run when the legislature adjourned on the 73rd day out of 90 with an unbalanced budget and turned right around and turned it over to the governor to fix, and I felt that was just very irresponsible.
Thank you, Mr. Phelps. We will move on now to our questions. Again, they will be asked this evening representing the media side, Mr. Patrick Lowry from the Hayes Daily News. And again, the questions and responses will be a minute 30 each. As I told you a moment ago, Ms. Boldra won the coin flip. She elected to go second as we asked those questions. So I will turn it over to Mr. Lowry and Mr. Phelps.
All righty. Thank you. Well, good day to both of you. I guess we'll start off with it's almost an odd thing to have a rematch. 4 years ago, we were in this very same room. The roles were reversed. You were the incumbent. You were the challenger. And obviously, you won. So my question, just to start off, is what's it like facing the same opponent for the same race?
What's it like?
And what's it going to, why would you think anything's going to be different this time?
Well, for me, I tend to just pretty much move forward on my points of view and whatever agenda I have. So I think I've always kind of done that. I'm focused on the particular issues that are facing our state and my concern. And I'm also, this time, I think, having an opponent that has a record that we can look at and scrutinize. I felt my record as a legislator, especially as it pertained to education, was woefully distorted the last time around. This time I'm looking at running against someone that has a record that I think for all practical purposes is quite questionable, because we look at the situation. We have a governor with probably the lowest polling rating in the state of Kansas, and we have quite a few legislators that have been voting with him on a number of issues, a number of key issues. And so as I go door to door and talk to the citizens of Hayes, I'm finding out that they're very concerned. They're very much paying attention. So this particular time, I think instead of just moving forward with my points of view, I'm taking into consideration the opponent's record. And I believe it's very questionable. And I think I'm very concerned as well as the citizens in Hayes.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Phelps. Let's go now to Ms. Boldra's response. Again, 90 seconds.
Thank you. I am a teacher. I am one of you. I'm not a career politician. I haven't been doing this for the last 20 years. I do think I've done a good job. Simply because I'm a Republican doesn't mean that I have followed the governor at every stance. My record on education is very strong. I had tried to fix the tax issue with the LLCs, the loophole, and I voted for that for 2 years. I actually am not being endorsed by the chamber, the Kansas chamber, this year, because that is the governor's chamber. And I have not voted with the governor enough times. I've been my own person, and I intend to be. I think I'm very qualified for the job. As I said, I'm just a citizen legislator trying to do the best that I can and looking out for the constituents of the 111th District. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Boldra. Now back to you, Mr. Lowry, for our second question, and Ms. Boldra will be the first to respond.
Okay, very good. The income tax reductions implemented in 2012 and 13 were significant, and it certainly has changed the course of the state economy. We've had 10 rounds of budget cuts. We've had two significant sales tax increases to try to counter it. And we still are in this current budget year with a structural imbalance of almost $350,000. Do you believe, as the governor does, that year five is going to be when it all happens and the shot of adrenaline long delayed will finally get here and these income tax cuts will prove worthwhile?
No. I don't. I don't think this will be a pretty year at all. I think that there has been a perfect storm. I was not in the legislature when that tax bill was passed in 2012. I was not part of that. I think it might have been a good idea. I was hopeful that it might be. But as we all know, commodity prices are at the bottom. And that's what we do out here in Western Kansas. Oil and gas prices are lower than they've been for 40 years. That's what we do in Western Kansas. It was kind of a perfect storm where everything just went under. And the governor has not stepped up to say we need to change. That's why I have been fighting to put that LLC loophole back in. We have some other ideas we'd like to try. This is going to be a difficult year. It's not going to be a rosy year. But I'm willing to work for this. I want to be a part of this. Thank you.
Okay.
Mr. Phelps.
Well, as part of the legislature in 2012, I am proud to say that I did vote in opposition to the governor's income tax cut plan that he had put forth. Apparently, I listened to the right people because as I talked to the legislative research and the budget analysts, they pretty much predicted exactly where we would be today. And so I stood up to the governor and voted in opposition. And to this day, I've been proved right with that decision. Mrs. Boulder indicated that she was not in the legislature, which is true. But as recently as a year ago, in your publication, I believe she was quoted as saying the governor's tax plan is working, businesses are moving to Kansas, the tax cuts are working, people just need to be patient. I believe already at that time, a year ago, people were already growing impatient with waiting to see what was going to happen. But as we've seen, we've had massive cuts to education. Oftentimes I'm told that when you're running for office, you ought to be able to, in 30 seconds, tell why you're running. I think that's impossible right now when we look at all the areas of distress in our state, whether it be education, services for the elderly and the disabled, our infrastructure crumbling because we're not implementing the highway plan and so forth. So I think the tax cuts have been disastrous. It was predicted, and I voted in opposition to them, and I'm glad I did. But now the work at hand is to straighten things out.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Phelps. We'll move on to the next question, Mr. Lowry, and the first answer will come from Mr. Phelps.
Part of the problem that we have month to month is the revenue estimates and trying to predict how much income the state will have to work with to hopefully cover the expenses. And they seem to be off of increasing nature. I think 12 of the past 15 months they've been off rather significantly. Now the people that are on the consensus revenue group are the governor, legislative leaders, the revenue secretary, and economists from various state universities. It just strikes me as odd they can't get these numbers right. So it begs the question, are they purposely misleading us into having emergencies where we have to make cuts, or are they just not able to predict where the revenues are going to come from?
Mr. Phelps.
Well, one of the things I was always impressed with when I was in the legislature, was first elected back in 1997, was how accurate they were. It seemed to me that most of the time the estimates, consensus estimating group was pretty accurate. I believe what we're seeing now is, I think we still have qualified people serving that capacity, but there's such an uncertainty out there, and especially with the tax cuts that have taken place, people have taken advantage of that, and I think that they're not really reinvesting. You know, it should, we're not seeing the, you know, the job increases and so forth. But I think most importantly is that as they, you know, get to the point where they're going to do the quarterly estimates, they're looking at the states around us that are, you know, things are improving, our national economy is improving as well, and I believe they kind of actually take that in consideration. Unfortunately, we see increases in revenues and the, you know, an improving economy in Missouri, you know, which created 32,500 jobs, I believe, and the country created 2.5 million jobs last year. In the meantime, we continue to lose jobs in the state of Kansas, and I think the consensus estimating people are just real hopeful, and as they see things going well in Colorado, Oklahoma, Nebraska, South Dakota, and Iowa, they seem to think that maybe that's going to happen here, and it just keeps missing the point.
Thank you, Mr. Phelps. Ms. Boulder.
I have to agree somewhat with Mr. Phelps, but when they estimate, when they have been estimating, I think that these are a number of people who live in an ivory tower. I don't think that they understand the importance of rural Kansas in the economy. They were thinking that when the oil and gas prices went down, that everybody would spend more money because they'd pay less at the pump. So they'd have money to travel and to buy things, not even thinking about what was going to happen in western Kansas, where we are dependent on agriculture commodities and oil and gas prices. They didn't even take that into consideration. And then when they look at oil prices, they're talking about New York oil prices, not Kansas Common. I don't know why these people have not come on board, and I don't know who they are specifically, but they have missed it over and over, and I think they're in an ivory tower. I don't think they understand what we do in rural Kansas. I think so many people in the eastern part of the state don't understand the economy of western Kansas.
All right, thank you, Ms. Boulder. We'll move on to our next question, Mr. Lowry, and the first person to answer that, Ms. Boulder.
Okay. Last year when we passed the budget for 2017, yes. We passed it with that aforementioned deficit of, yes, $350 million. That is going to grow once we start adding in all the missed revenue, yes, estimates, all the delayed payments to schools that are going to now count in this fiscal year. How will you address that situation? What do you propose will be the solution for fiscal year 2017?
We have to pass a tax, a different tax law, a different tax code. We have to fix the LLC. When they did that originally, they assumed there'd be about 110,000 people take advantage of that LLC loophole, and that it would cost about $220 million. Well, now there are over 400,000 taking advantage of that. And so that would be $800 million, almost $1 billion. And so that's one of the first things we're going to try to do. And I voted for that twice and almost made it last time. But we also need to look at what we're spending money on. We need to look at the taxes. And I know people don't like taxes. I don't like to pay taxes. But if we want schools, if we want parks, if we want fire and police protection, if we want all those things, we're going to have to be taxed. The tax plan in 2012 was too far, too soon, and we're going to have to change that. I don't like raising taxes, but I think we're going to have to look at that. We don't have any other choice.
All right, Ms. Boulder, your response, Mr. Phelps?
Well, it's obviously there's a consensus out there that the 2012 tax cut package has been detrimental to our economy and things like job creation and businesses moving to Kansas. But I think there's some things we can do right away, because any debate on a tax plan, whether it be rolling back the 2012 tax cuts, is going to take a whole session. I believe what we need to do right off the bat when we get into the session would be to take advantage of some of the tools we have available. One is we have a approved high and funded comprehensive highway plan. We need to implement that. That's going to put people to create thousands of jobs immediately, and it's also going to be an infusion of cash into the communities. All you have to do is look at the last highway plan and look at what it did for, say, Garden City, for instance. So we can implement that. We've got a lot of people in our state, such as those in the oil industry, that have lost their jobs. There's a ready workforce out there, I believe, waiting. We can also expand Medicaid. You talk to any of the hospitals around here, they know that will be an instant assist for them. I believe Hayes Medical Center probably loses $1.5 million dollars a year because of the lack of the expansion. But that's going to bring in federal dollars, take away some of the money that's being borrowed from, say, the senior health care plan. We can also look at other areas that we can get matching funds, such as the arts, where we turned down $800,000.
All right, thank you, Mr. Phelps. Moving on now to our next question, Mr. Lowry, and the first respondent will be Mr. Phelps.
Okay, you mentioned the Department of Transportation, and I would hope that they've got enough money left in their accounts to even do any projects. It's affectionately called the Bank of KDOT. That's been utilized for years to plug budget holes, but again, it's something that's increased a lot since 2012. Mm-hmm. I think more than $2.7 billion has been swept out of there in that time frame, or a little bit longer. Last year, we lost 4,900 construction jobs, 4,400 construction jobs, making us 49th in the nation with construction jobs gained. So obviously we can do that, but that would have to imply we don't borrow any more money from the Department of Transportation. How can we do that in this fiscal year when we've got this huge imbalance to start with.
As I mentioned, if you implement it, you're going to be putting people to work who are going to get paid. They're going to buy consumer goods. They're going to add to our income taxes, because that category obviously is going to be assessed income tax. But also, they're going to be buying things, so that's going to add to our income taxes sales taxes throughout the state. In addition to that, when those highway jobs are created, when they come and do a project, for instance, in Hays, Kansas, and resurface 183, or come over here, in the Russell County area. What happens is you put people to work, and then all your ancillary businesses benefit from that as well. So there's going to be, when I talk about an infusion of cash, you're going to be going down to the auto parts business every morning. They're going to go buy, food at the restaurants, grocery stores, stay in the motels and what have you. So there is a matter of, you can either take that money and put it over here towards something else, or you can put that in somebody's pocket, and they're going to go spend part of it and add to our economy.
Okay.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Phelps. Ms. Boulder, your thoughts about the Bank of KDOT?
My answer is exactly what Mr. Phelps is. We have stolen from it too long. I voted against that the last time. And jobs, we are watching a lot of construction still in the eastern part of the state. You see around Kansas City and Lawrence, there's still a lot of construction. There isn't much construction going on out here. And here in western Kansas, we need those roads. We need transportation as much as they do back in the eastern part. That's the way our grains travel. That's the way we get around. Kansas is the third, I think, state. We have the third most paved highways in the nation behind Texas and California. And look at the size of those two states. So we have done a good job, but we've got to keep them up. Our bridges, our infrastructure are in trouble. We have to do exactly that. We cannot continue to raid. The chair of that group was Mr. King. And, he all the time was saying, it's okay. We've got money. Go ahead. You can use this. And then after a while, he finally resigned his position. So I think that's over. I think we can't be raiding the Bank of Kansas any longer. I agree.
Thank you, Ms. Boulder. Our next question, Mr. Lowry, and again, will be first answered by Ms. Boulder.
All righty. This seems like a broken record. It's because it's been happening so much. There have been so many different techniques employed, what I would call accounting maneuvers, to try to plug holes and get through to the next month or the next year. One of them last year was the vote to float a $1 billion worth of pension obligation bonds and then invest that money into the stock market in hopes of an 8% return. That would beat the 5% we're going to have to pay out for interest payments on the bonds. Though last year, it has not been that good. I don't even think it was 1% return on that investment. It's a long-term project.
Sure.
However, what kind of commitment are we going to be able to convey to our retirees that there is going to be any money left when they retire or 10 years into their retirement? Because in addition to this borrowing scheme, we've also just been delaying payments for the last 2 years.
Yes, and you're talking about the CAPERS payment?
Yes,
and that is very worrisome. I do want to say that CAPERS itself is a lockbox. Once the money goes in, we can't raid CAPERS. We can delay payments, the state payment to it, but we can't delay the money that the people and the school districts and other entities have put in there. And once it's in, it can't be taken back out. You are right. However, when Mr. Phelps was a representative, they didn't pay into CAPERS for 2 years. So we were really at the bottom. When the current administration went in, that was one of the first things they wanted to do, was to beef up our payment to CAPERS. And for the first 3 or 4 years, we did pay $1 million 4 times a year. We now are at that point where I guess we're not going to be able to pay it in the budget last year. That was one of the assurances that we would pay that KDOT back, the CAPERS back at 8%. But if we don't have the money, I guess that payment may not be made. But that is one thing that I'm on top of. Steve Johnson is the head of the pensions, and I talk with him often. But thank you.
Okay.
Thank you, Ms. Boldre. Mr. Phelps, your thoughts about the State Employees Capers Fund?
Well, anytime you talk about capers, the first thing you want to do is assure the people that are enrolled or at least filed for their benefits, they're going to be okay. You know, it's a pretty solid fund right now in spite of the fact that the state has been negligent in paying into that fund for the last couple of years. On the other hand, those that are coming into the state workforce, teachers or what have you, might be a little bit concerned, or should be greatly concerned, as we move forward and continue to renege on those payments. I think a sound economy, which is should be coming along if we get more responsible administrators and more responsible legislators coming in and actually look at that problem and take on that responsibility. As I mentioned some of the things before, once we start doing some things that are actually improving the economy and possibly rolling back to the 2012 tax code that we had here in our state, we'll probably see some increased benefit as far as revenues coming in the state. I think at that time, it's up to legislative members to stand up to the governor and make sure those payments are made.
All right, thank you. Our next question, Mr. Lowry, and the first respondent will be Mr. Phelps.
Okay, the K-12 public education consumes over half of the general fund budget, and we got rid of the old finance formula 2 years ago, and the block grant system that was put in place and found unconstitutional is set to expire in 2017. Mr. Phelps, what do you think the next step should be? And for Representative Boldre, I'd like to ask you that same thing, but also offer what you think was wrong with the old finance formula, if you would.
All right, starting with Mr. Phelps.
Well, first of all, the school finance formula that we had in place, I cringe when I hear people say it's broken, that it's antiquated, and so forth, and that it needs to be fixed. The problem that we had with the school finance formula that was implemented in 1992 is that it wasn't funded at the level that should have been funded. So I think that we had a great formula. It leveled the playing field. It's probably one of the greatest success stories of bipartisanship in the state of Kansas as far as people from both sides of the aisle working together to do something that benefited kids in the state of Kansas. Everybody always wants to throw out what that represents as far as a percentage of our budget. We have 460,800 students in the state of Kansas. That's a 500,000. So when you have a base aid formula, obviously that's going to be a lot of money. I think what we need to do is to go back, take that formula, and it's set up so that you can make adjustments to it as population trends change and as far as other demographics. So to say that it's broken is totally false. You can talk to any education expert in the state of Kansas, they'll tell you that the problem is it just wasn't funded. And all the times that it was, we made sure that we had the same opportunity for somebody in Weston, Kansas as we did in Shawnee.
All right, Ms. Boldre.
Mr. Phelps said, that was the original one was instituted in 1992. Over that time, we made adjustments for rural schools, we made adjustments for inner city schools, we made adjustments, and then it kind of became a mosaic of different things that had been added or subtracted over the years. And it, for many people, it didn't make sense anymore. For one thing, if you had internet students, and some schools made a lot of money on internet students, you got paid 1.05 of a student. That's a lot more than a kindergartner gets per student. So, they don't ever ask to go to the bathroom. You don't have to get them books. You don't have to give them a place. They're on the internet. They should have less than a full-time student. There are things like that. We need to get this done. We're supposed to get it done by 2017. My hope was that we would do this early enough that we could put this over whatever we came up with over the six innovative districts first. KCK is the largest school, but one of the poorest. Blue Valley is a large school, but one of the richest is a 6A school. And then you have McPherson, which is a 4A school, and it's a very good school. And then you have Hugoton, Marysville, and I forget the third one. And those are all small rural schools. And so if we could put this over them first and see what works for them all. The rural schools obviously have transportation issues and needs. I would like to see that, but we don't have time to do that now. We're going to have to get a formula, and there'll be the experiment again. But I'm hopeful that we can come up with something this year. All right. We have to.
Thank you, Ms. Boulder. Our next question, Mr. Lowry.
Okay. We'll stick with the same topic. Mm-hmm. While we're working on that formula, hanging in over our heads still from the last one is the state Supreme Court ruling on the adequacy of the funding.
Yes.
Most people that look at the situation guess they're going to come back with a pretty steep price tag of how much we're underfunding. And the estimates range from $500 million to $1 billion that we might have to come up with for this fiscal year.
Yes.
How will we do that?
I don't know. I don't know how we do that. And I do understand that the courts have the right to say something is unconstitutional. But I still don't believe that the courts have the power of the purse. You know, constitutionally, they can come up with a remedy, and they can suggest it, and they can try to help us get there. But I don't think it's up to the courts to give us a price tag. I've never thought that that was correct. We did come back, as you know, in the special session last year and put another $40 million in there for the equity portion.
Right.
And now we're going to look at adequacy. I don't know where it's going to come from. We also have a lot of other groups that need some of that money. We have a lot of people. The IDD population hasn't had increases for years. And of course, we have people in poverty who need this. We have the elderly who need some of this cash. So if we do come up with, if we do get a tax, a new tax bill, if we do have, of course, taxes won't come in really until the next year anyway.
Right.
So if we find a way to fill the holes, I'm a little upset that perhaps, although I'm an educator, that so much of it will be directed toward education. However, you are correct. That is the only thing in the Kansas Constitution that we are required to pay, and that is for schools.
Right.
Thank you.
Okay. Mr. Phelps.
I think the first thing you got to realize with the Supreme Court decision is the fact that they're not really trying this case as much as they are as interpreting the law. So we do have a constitutional law that requires us to educate every child in the state of Kansas. I haven't really seen where the Supreme Court's actually come out with the dollar figure, but they do take into consideration the school finance formula that we have in place. Obviously, the system that that we have in place right now, where they eliminated the old school finance formula and brought in the block grants, I think is very detrimental. First of all, it needs to be looked at face value, and that is the fact that all it is a freeze on what was funded in 2013. And that's to carry on to 2017 without taking any consideration of increased enrollments or even lost enrollment for that matter. But I think some of the things I mentioned earlier, if we start getting people back to work, that's going to increase some revenues. And I believe the Supreme Court will probably look at the state of Kansas, at least if we can make a good faith effort. You know, it's going to be a steep price tag, as you mentioned, but I think there's been no effort to really comply with the earlier decisions that have been put forth by the Supreme Court. And I think it's time that we took their advice, or at least their decision, and move forward.
Okay.
All right, Mr. Lowry, next question, and a first response from Mr. Phelps.
Okay, thank you. Despite opposition from the Board of Regents, individual universities, student government organizations, staff, faculty, campus police chiefs, and other law enforcement officials statewide, beginning July 1 of next year, people will be able to carry concealed firearms on campus without a permit. Do you support leaving this law in place? Why or why not?
I've listened to a number of Regents presidents, as well as talking to law enforcement on the college campuses, and I believe they do have a legitimate concern. One thing that, as the state's been moving forward with all the budget crisis we have, everybody's concerned about costs incurred, and most universities, especially the law enforcement on the university campus, have told me that to have this type of a decision made actually brings about some unforeseen circumstances as far as costs. So I think the bill was actually, in my opinion, passed a little bit recklessly without giving consideration of what kind of cost that was going to have to the campuses, but also people that are in that business protecting the students on campus, I think have a little bit better handle on what's going on in the campuses, and most of them perceive a lot of potential dangers with students that might be carrying concealed weapon. Because not only do you have security going in and out of a building, you have to have concern for the security within the building. And this day and age, with cutbacks to mental health funding and so forth, I think we need to look at this issue a little closer. So I did not support that, and think it's a good idea.
All right, Ms. Boulder, your response.
Thank you. I would like to go back one step before, though, when Mr. Phelps said that there was no good faith effort to try to help the schools, and I disagree with that, because when we went back for special session, there were many people who just wanted to play around with it and not do anything, and there were some of us who said no, they're asking for $38 million, let's give them the 40 and get this done. That was a good faith effort. I disagree with that. As far as concealed carry, I know a number of people, concealed means concealed, you don't know it. I know a number of people who concealed carry on campus now. I know a number of legislators who conceal carry in the State House. Concealed means that you have met the requirements, that you have taken a test, that you know how to use a firearm, and that in many cases, if someone would have had a firearm, some of the tragedies across the nation would not have happened if someone would have just had something to fire back. The gentleman in Colorado, he found the one movie theater that said no guns allowed. I understand the issues, and I understand the concerns, but bottom line, there are concealed carry weapons out there right now.
All right, thank you.
Which was illegal, correct?
No, it's not illegal for concealed carry.
Okay.
On the school campuses,
on
yes.
On the school campuses,
yes.
And in the State House.
No, it's not in the State House. It is not illegal.
Okay, interesting. And I just want to follow this
yes.
up on this. Granted, there could have been,
should have, would have, could have.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Been a stop to any of these incidents of mass shootings.
Right.
Do you not think that introducing even more weapons into such an environment could also have the opposite effect and increase the number of incidents? Is that just as feasible?
Perhaps, but I don't believe so. I personally do not believe so. If you have a concealed carry license, that's what it has to be. It can't just be somebody putting it in their pocket. They have to have the paperwork that says they have a right to conceal carry. And that means a process. It's just not anyone who sticks it in their pocket and say, I'm concealed carrying. That is a special permit, and that's what you'd have to have. It's not just everybody carrying a gun in their pocket, concealing it. You have to be, you have to go through the process to receive that. You have to be of age. You have to take the test. You have to, the federal firearms licenses have to be there. There are steps to take. It's not just put it in your pocket and say, I'm concealed carrying.
Okay.
All right. Let's let Mr. Phelps do any follow-up on
yes.
that. And you had mentioned something about the mental health funding. How does that apply in this situation?
Well, I think it applies greatly. We've seen our community mental health centers, go through massive cuts in time. And so in any situation anymore, you have a lot of people dealing with mental illness that under the proper medication, can operate pretty much a normal life. And so when I talk to people at the university, we have a number of students, that are suffering from depression and other issues. And if they are, unable to get the proper funding for their medication and so forth, you just increase the instances. But my concern over the whole concealed carry on the campuses is based on what I've heard from law enforcement, where they are concerned when they get a call that there's a shooting, a gun being fired, and they walk into a situation, they need to know who's who. And so I think you increase the possibilities of some bad things happening.
All right, we have time for about two more questions, Mr. Lowry, so I'll let you proceed, and Mr. Phelps will be the first respondent to your next question.
Okay. There has been a push, a move, if you will, by the governor's office to try to gain more control over the selection process of Supreme Court justices. First of all, do you support that? And more broadly, what do you think is more important? Having a court rule in favor of laws passed by the legislature or rulings that are based on the Constitution?
Before I answer that, clarification to Mrs. Boldra, when I mentioned good faith effort, I wasn't referring to the last session. I was saying that I would hope that the Supreme Court, if they come through with another decision, and we, you know, have to come up with a pretty big, you know, payday, so to speak, for the school funding, that if the legislature at least made a good faith effort, that they would be in support of that. I do not support the idea of the governor, you know, having taking control of the selection of Supreme Court justices. Obviously, many people know we have three branches of government, and they're all separate, and I don't think one needs to be controlling over the other one, especially, you know, on a partisan type of level. I think the system we've had in place works just fine. When some people will say, if it works, don't fix it, I don't really go by that. I say, if it works, make it better. And I think right now the selection process we have by members of the legal community, you know, a nominating committee, and then submitting those names to the governor, I think has worked just fine in the past, and I would hope that that would continue. I think with the decisions made by the Supreme Court, I'm not sure exactly how your question went, but they fully are in the position to rule on constitutionality. They also are there to interpret the law as it is in the legislative statutes. And so I think any meddling with their selection or telling them how to make decisions or whatever is up to the Supreme Court or to the judicial branch.
All right, Ms. Boldra.
I thought that was a very interesting debate that we had on the floor about changing the makeup of the Supreme Court or the way they're chosen. And I voted for it, not because I want to change it, but because the whole idea, it's in the Constitution. So it would take a constitutional amendment. So if we would vote for it, it wouldn't have changed anything. It would have allowed the people to see it on the ballot. Let the people decide. I think that's an issue that's been around for quite a while. You know, I taught government. I kind of like the federal system, the way, you know, the president selects and then the Senate has to determine whether or not they have to confirm. I kind of like that. And I understand that at the state level we've done it differently for a lot of years. But there is a lot of controversy right now with our Supreme Court being overturned by the U.S. Supreme Court on six different issues in the past few years. And so there are some people that think that maybe there ought to be changes. I don't know. I don't have a real opinion, but I think I would like to let the people decide. It's a constitutional amendment. It would have to go on the ballot first.
All right. This will be our final question for the evening. Mr. Lowry and Ms. Boldra will respond first.
Okay. The Kansas Endowment for Youth and the Children's Initiative Fund were established by the legislature under the Tobacco Master Settlement Agreement.
Yes.
The annual revenue that comes into the state goes through those funds and in turn helps fund early childhood prevention, education, all sorts of things. We are sweeping money directly from those funds into the general budget. Do you support that practice? And if not, what will you do to stop it?
Well, I'm not sure I agree. We get $52 million from them every year. And last year, they were considering taking it all in a lump sum, which would be much less than $52 million every year. And no, we weren't going to let him do that. In the budget, he said, well, you know, they were talking about just getting that to fill a hole once, and yeah, we're not going to do that. Right now, as for what I understand is, it is $52 million and $48 million has always gone to the Children's Fund. And the other six has gone to the General Fund. And that is what we left in the budget. That was one of the reasons that I voted for the budget. They couldn't touch K-12 education, and they couldn't do anything else with that. He could do whatever he wanted to with the $6 million, but the $48 had to stay in the Children's Fund. And as far as I know, that's exactly what happened. I don't know that they have swept the $48 million.
I believe a good 16 of it was swept in his last round of $37 million of cuts.
I do not know that.
That you did allow that the legislature gave the governor permission to cut wherever he saw fit. And I think he went after them again.
I thought that was protected in that last budget bill. I will have to check that. I don't know that. I have not heard that. Nobody from DCF has called me, and I have very good friends there in Topeka and DCF. I know that he gets the 6 or the 8 or whatever is left over, but the 42 is supposed to be guaranteed for the children's funds. Okay.
All right. Your response, Mr. Phelps.
I'm a firm believer that the biggest bang for your buck is investment in children, especially even in the early childhood areas. Few years back, there was a commission called the 2010 Commission, reviewed our whole education system and everything. And one of their initiatives, or at least one of their main points that they wanted to make out, was if you have to cut education, do not cut the early childhood programs. That's an area where all of our screenings take place, and in my opinion, that's where you do a lot of cost savings, because you can catch things early on, whether it be sight or hearing impaired issues with a child, and also just with behavioral issues as well. So it seems to me all across the country, we're spending a lot of money on remedial programs, whether it be at the high school level or ultimately with our prison system. And it seems to me that you can head off a lot of problems very early on. So I think if there's one area that the legislature, the governor, whomever, needs to keep their hands off of, that is the funding, the dollars that are in the early childhood programs.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Phelps. Well, we've come now to the time for our closing statements, and we will actually reverse the order of our opening statements, which means that Ms. Boldrow will give her closing statement first, and then Mr. Phelps will conclude with his. Both of these statements should be about 90 seconds. We'll start, first of all, with Ms. Boldrow's closing statement.
Thank you, everyone. I would like to take just a few minutes to say that Mr. Phelps was there during the Great Recession in the legislature. And at that time, they did take $100 million from the schools. He voted to take $100 million from public broadcasting. He voted to he voted not to put in $86 million in 2010 into education. So I think it's a little bit disingenuous to attack me for what's going on now when he was there when it was just as bad. And those are some of the decisions, the hard decisions, that we have to make when we're in the legislature. And I have not cut funding for education. I've done the jobs that most of you have done. I've been a farmer, a teacher, a parent, a grandparent, a small business owner. I'm an educator, not a career politician. My lifelong mission is to serve. I've served you and your children by teaching them. I'm serving you in the state legislature because I share the same experiences that you have. Our state is struggling right now. There's no reason to point fingers. It's time to go to work. And I will work for you. I will work with you. I will listen to you. I will talk to you. And I will vote for you. This is not about power. It's not about control. It's about a decision to serve my constituents, the common man serving the common man. This is what I do. This is what I've always done. When you go to the polls, please consider voting for Sue Boldrow. Thank you for your time. God bless you all, and God bless the United States of America. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Boldrow. And Mr. Phelps, your closing statement, please.
Once again, thank you to Smoky Hill and to our moderators and to my worthy opponent. It's been a pleasure to share some of my thoughts on various issues facing the state of Kansas. I believe that there are some real wrongs need to be righted in our state. And that would be my goal if I were to be elected again, is to turn some things around, especially in the areas of education funding and also how we treat our seniors who have left us a great legacy with a state that is really great to live in, raise a family, and see your children get educated. And now what I'm seeing with the way our seniors are being treated with massive cuts to the Senior Care Act, we have seniors on waiting lists for in-home services. I would challenge Ms. Boldrow with her statements that I voted against public broadcasting. During debates where amendments were offered to cut funding, I was probably one of the most vocal in opposition to that. I had a glowing career, I guess you could say, in the legislature with my support of education. In fact, In this election, I've been endorsed by the Kansas National Education Association, Families for Education, and also Women for Kansas, who one of their main platforms is education. So the last election, my votes on education and my support of education was questioned, and there could be nothing further from the truth. I was on the House Education Committee for 14 years, and those are some of the proudest moments in my life. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Phelps. Thank you for being with us this evening, and thank you so much to the people who have given of their times and talents and insights into the Kansas legislature. Again, Challenger Eber Phelps of Hayes, who is a Democrat, and our Republican incumbent, Sue Boulder, also of Hayes, and this is House District 111, and of course, that is about the southeast corner of Ellis County, which includes Hayes, Munger, and Victoria. I also want to thank our media representative, Mr. Pat Lowry from the Hayes Daily News, who is the editor and publisher there. Thank you for bringing these issues to light for us and having a discussion. We appreciate it very much. I thank you again for watching. I'm Becky Kaiser with Hayes Post, and you've been watching this edition of the Kansas Candidates Forum right here on Smoky Hills Public Television.